Good morning. I heard that you are all very excited about this presentation, right? Okay, good. Well, you know, I always work in civil society, so I'm not very measured like researchers, academicians, or diplomats, or politicians. So I want us to be very free this morning to speak about gender issues. Yesterday, when we finished our course, our discussion, one of the participants approached us and said, oh, tomorrow is about gender, and I hate this gender discussion. And you know, I really, really, really appreciate that, because that's the fear of many people. You know, when we talk about gender, people think that gender is some kind of tension between men and women, which is not the case. And that's the misunderstanding. And that's why there's resistance. Because most of the time when people explain the concept, either they don't explain it properly, or people just develop fear and they feel like, you know, it's going to take something from them. I'm going to use example on South Africa, which is an African case, because sometimes when you cannot understand gender, it's good to talk about race, so you can kind of relate to the concept. So I kind of selected many images to talk, so I don't bore you. And what I think is important for me, I was asked to talk about three questions. What are the gender perspective in peace and security, and what is the importance of it? And then I was asked to talk about who are the key stakeholders, who should be involved, and then to make recommendations. But those discussions will be baseless when you don't know the concept of gender and do not understand, because we will go to the discussion room and we start arguing, and that's not the point. So I will be talking about the concept. If we don't finish, please do not be afraid to ask your question, because that's how we will have, when we communicate, we will have an understanding. So it's about perception. And perception are very important in this kind of discussion. But at the same time, since you are in peace and security, I think conflict starts with conflicting perception. So if we look at perception, we can look at the same thing and we see different things. But if we take the time to discuss and to communicate, we might be able to see each other's point of view, right? Okay, then you can ask. So basically, we are all wearing lenses. We are all wearing glasses. And our lenses are shaped by the culture, your religion, your level of education, and so on. And automatically, nobody can come and change your perception about gender. But what we can do is to have a discussion. And Socrates said, I cannot teach anybody anything. All I can do is to make them think. So today, that's the point. I'm not here to teach you anything, but for us to think about the gender issues. Now, what is gender? Can anybody try just one time? What is gender? Yes. Of course, she's part of the one-app clique.
Thank you, ma'am. Gender is the role society ascribes to individual based on their sexes.
Okay. Thank you very much. That's good enough. So basically, we are born men, women, or different sex, transgender or whatever, you know, we are born that way biologically. But gender is an ascribed status that is given to you based on your sex. There's no universal gender role. It depends from country to country. It depends from culture to culture. And it depends on different parameters. So gender issue is not also stagnant. It changes over time. And I will get that when we talk about Africa. At the same time, why is this gender is important? It's important because in some places, it defines who has access to opportunities, who have access to education. Can you work? Can you choose even the right or certain thing on your body and so on? So gender, we have to have an understanding about gender in order for policymakers to really make the right decision that benefit everybody. Now, why gender is important? Qualitatively, first of all, our gender, as I say, is shaped by many things. Most of the time, children are socialized. You see the little girls, and she will play with the dolls, and the little guy is playing with cars and gun and so on. That's how it began, the socialization. As you can see again, gender role play a major role. So why is it important? Let's look at quantitatively. Women make 50% of the population almost in every country in Africa or more. So they are the majority of the population. These are data from the UN. They perform 2/3 of the world work. They make up 2/3 of the world illiterate. Women earn, and this is not only in Africa, women earn 1/10 of the world income and property, as you can see, 1/100 of land ownership. 70% of the world poor are women, and 85% of the refugee and IDP's population are women and children. So qualitatively, when we look at conflict, we can see that women bear the brunt of conflict. Quantitatively, I had given you the number. Then you should ask yourself, whose security are you talking about? These are the majority of the population. If you add youth to women, the youth female, male, and so on, 75% of the population. So whose security are we talking about? We need to keep that in mind. Is gender only about women? People keep saying that. And I will say yes and no. So you can see some of the images of women carrying multitasking and so on. Is gender only about men or women? Let's look at South Africa. I really need to get this out. Let's look at South Africa. During apartheid, it was institutional culture, and usually we back it with policies, we back it with religion, and we say, okay, I take the case of South Africa. Black could not do certain things. You could not go to certain school, you could not have certain level of education, and so on. And then we realize that apartheid is really bad. It's bad because the majority of the population were denied basic right to have education, to have access to job, and so on. Then we say, okay, we are banishing apartheid, no more apartheid. Now, we tell the whites who have all those years of opportunities, education, and so on, and a black person who live in poverty and was denied so many things, and say, now there's equality. You can both apply to this particular job. That is not equality, because they don't have the same starting point. Do you understand? That's why the same thing with women. In many, many cultures, women were denied, you know, food culture, education, and I don't know, opportunities to work, land ownership, and so on. And we realize we cannot move forward with half of our population behind. And we tell women, oh yeah, you can have any job you want. You can be colonel, you can be general, you can be a president. No, really, it doesn't work that way. What you do, the group you left behind, you need to help them to catch up with the one which is so advanced. So, in apartheid, you will not tell white people, hey, you guys have moved too far. Stop here and wait for the black people to catch up with you. When you do that, you discriminate against them. So you don't tell women and the men, hey, wait there for the women to catch up with you. You will discriminate against the men. You don't tell the men, hey, come back and meet the women so you can move together. Again, you will discriminate. You will create a lot of unhappy people. What you do is the group that is left behind, the women, you give them the resources and the opportunity to accelerate so that they can be at the same level and move. So that's where the focus on women in the gender discussion comes. Simple as that. The person left behind, you help to catch up with the resources and the means to move together. Okay. I think we have discussed that. So gender is about the power dynamic between men and women. Is gender a Western concept? Many Africans resist gender issue and say, yeah, it's a European thing, and you know, all these Western people come and shuffle this in our throat and so on. Well, it's not a Western concept. If you take Switzerland, women have the right to vote in the 70s. African women never have to fight for the right to vote. In Africa, pre-colonial Africa, from Dahomey to Ghana to RDC and Jinsehu, we can tell me, women were in position of power. There were division of labor, but women were not, let's say, oh, you take your husband's last name or something like that. No, even today, in some African country, I have some friend from DRC, two brothers, same father, same mother. One have the father last name, one have the mother last name. You go to Ghana today, the queen mother in the Ashanti culture still have a word to say and is ruling and is being listened and advising. So gender is not a Western concept. Anybody resisting gender is the one who is lost, because we cannot advance with half of our population left behind. And General Agwe said, it's like you are having a football team of 11 people and you decide you're going to play only with 5. But I will tell you, it's like having 2 legs to play football and you start to jump on 1. You might score your goal, but with great difficulty. So this is half of the potential in Africa that we decide to leave behind. There's no way, I don't care what kind of policy, what kind of money you fuel in peace and security and development, an African can move forward with half of our potential left behind, period. Now, why? Who is vulnerable in conflict and why? The vulnerability we have seen. Men can be raped in conflict, and it happens a lot. And women are raped too. And both of them are traumatized, have health issues, and so on. But women, when women is raped, the consequence, she can be pregnant. And when she's pregnant, she's rejected from her community with that child. And so the differential impact is both of them can be raped, but women, when she's raped, she pays the consequences in the family and in her community. And this is just one example. You can see when I was showing the images, I'm really lost with my images here. All those are women. Sometimes, and I'm not doing that to undermine men, when conflict broke, men take off. Women will drag their children from border to border, from country to country for days and days. Look at them. One in the front, one in the back, 2 on the thing. They will never leave the kids. These are the differential impact on women and conflict. So that makes women vulnerable. But they're not only vulnerable, they're agent of change as well. Women are just not consumer of security. Most of the major conflict, let me just jump, in many, many countries, Liberia. Who stopped the war in Liberia? These are women. Through the Witness program, they mobilize and have the negotiation in Akosombo in Ghana and stop the conflict. In the table, what were the men, fighter discussing? Who have the Ministry of Mine? Who have the Ministry of Economy? And who have the Ministry of Finance? You go to DRC again. Women mobilize themselves to cross those high forests, very dangerous, to go and mobilize all the actors to come together and stop the conflict. And during the mediation, they decided, no, you cannot sit at the table. You are not smart enough. You are not good enough. You are not qualified enough. But women form a committee. And it is those committees they have discussed healthcare, education, water, and so on. As General Agwe say, it's not that you don't have formal education, that you don't have experience. A woman who is raped during the conflict have more experience than any of us sitting here. And no book can display her experience. So we need in Liberia, for instance, when they were restructuring the army, what happened? Many women were not qualified academically and so on. They put down the threshold to make sure that they bring some women and train them to catch up. And that's what an emerging leader, a good leader will do. But not to say, oh, no, you don't have the qualification, you don't have the potential to do this. Now, we have seen in Rwanda, the most advanced country on this planet are the country who have utilized the potential of their women. Rwanda, of course, it was because of the war. Most of the men were killed. So, but Kagame could still say, hey, go to the kitchen and don't show up. But they have integrated women, and look where Rwanda is today. During the recession, World War II in the US, when the men were gone, we were here to work, it was the women again. The Nordic country, why are they so advanced? Because they have ensured that men and women are working together to advance society. So, equality referred to similarity of treatment as is legally, constitutionally, and divinely given. It is a fundamental right. But equity is about opportunities and fairness in the system. I had some beautiful picture about that one, I cannot. So the equity is just one measure of equality. Now, access versus control. When it comes even to land during the conflict and things, you say, oh, they have access. No, when you have access, you might not have control, taking decision to sell the land, to do this and that. So you as policymaker, you need to understand these terms. My point here is to make you understand gender. And the rest about the normative framework, how to do gender mainstreaming, gender analysis, and so on, you can go online and find those information. Now, we have seen some leaders, like Abdoulaye Wade in Senegal. Again, what I'm saying about this leader, I'm not saying they're perfect. But Abdoulaye Wade had done a lot to advance gender issue in Dakar and Senegal. And that's even why the ECOWAS Gender Center is based in Dakar. So my recommendation to you, you have to first change your own mindset. Because you can change your institution if yourself you are displaying resistance. So you need to recognize your own resistance. Again, gender is not a stagnant concept. When we were in Dakar at some point with an ACSS program, and some guy was telling me from one of the Sahel region, this is my culture. Oh, you are going too fast. Too fast for who? And this gender issue is against our culture and so on. And one of the military from the US, a colonel, black guy, say, in the US military, just in the 60s, black people were not allowed to integrate and do certain things. So gender is not stagnant, but our mind is stagnant. So unlock it so you can, big, fantastic leaders, effective leaders, and Africa can live up to its potential. We are not going too fast. How fast? Ask the people who are suffering, the women who are suffering, how fast we are going. So acknowledge your own resistance. When we say about gender, we need male voice. And most of the time, when we say gender, women are the police of gender. How? This is a power dynamic between men and women. If men are not coming to talk, how can we change that dynamic? So there is a need for men and women to work together to dismantle this this issue. You have to identify the gap within your institutions. And effectively, they are inclusive. Today, we are talking about sustaining peace concept at the global level with the UN and Agenda 2030. The concept of Agenda 2030 is like there is no peace. We cannot sustain peace if we are not inclusive in every way. And the inclusivity, the focus is on our youth and on women. And finally, all we've been talking about all this time is about institutions, it's not about us. As long as we remember that we come and go, but we need to leave a strong institution behind us. So you need to take the right step, get the training you need. There's no shame if you don't understand gender. I worked recently with some women from Bangui, high-level women, and some of them work in UNDP for 20 years. And then one of them came to talk about gender. I entered under the table. I was like, oh my God. And I realized that sometimes even the so-called gender experts, they confuse people, and that's why people have tension and all kind of thing. It's not supposed to do that, to be that way. And finally, you have to see the potential in people. As Einstein said, if you ask a fish to climb a tree, you will not see the quality of the fish as a swimmer. Or you ask a monkey to swim, then you will not see how the monkey can jump from tree to tree. Women have potential. See the potential of those people in your institution who are working under you, and give them opportunity. And again, every international human rights laws talk about, and our constitution, about non-discrimination, equality, justice, and fairness. Effective leaders, what they are fluent in courage and their strategies. And that's why Thomas Sankara, until today, we are not romanticizing about him, but he has seen that really Burkina Faso could not advance when, you know, women were left behind. So for men to understand the experience of women, he made the men go out to do the work of the women for at least one day to know what their wives are going through. So I think, again, to be a champion of gender mainstreaming and gender equality, you have to allocate budget. If you don't allocate budget, there's no way you can accomplish this. And I am so grateful to ACSS under Kate's leadership and, you know, to our course director, Doreen, for not only integrating this, but addressing it the first week. Because gender has to be mainstream in every discussion. Every discussion we are having, we need to integrate. So I thank you, and I'm ready for your question.